soluble, yeah? Thanks for the very nice introduction. Yeah, well, the definition of the molecular plant physiology was very well said, but if you look at the title, it says climate change and food production in Asia. So it's basically a very broad topic that I thought of covering so that I don't become too focused in one particular thing, but then have a very wide view of things, what's happening in the area. So I wouldn't get too much into the metabolics and stuff, but I will give you an overview of different activities that are happening at IRI with respect to climate change. Yeah? So there are other co-authors on this paper that you can see, Sethi, Arvind Kumar and RK. These are all different groups which are working at IRI on different aspects related to climate change. So I don't need to introduce why we have been working on rice, but just to reiterate that fact, as you can see in the slide over here, nearly 450 million people who depend on who earn less than $1.25 per day, that are, who are on the border of the poverty line, depend on rice. And majority of these people come under South Asia, and just followed by Southeast Asia and East Asia. So it just reiterates the fact, the importance of working on rice and the great objective of working that IRI has been involved with. So if you look into the future as a global rice demand, as this slide shows, you would require an additional rice, or the milled rice, by 160 million tons by 2035. So if you look at this, what it shows here is the red one, wherein there's going to be an increasing amount of demand for this rice, especially in the Asian continents. And also if you look at 2015, then you start to see an increase in this demand going up in Africa as well. So from this slide, it can be summarized that we certainly have to increase this rice production, and there's no way that we can stop anywhere, but we just have to pursue our efforts. Now, of course, we need to produce so much more for the future, but then we have another challenge to face. On top of that, we have the climate change, which is happening much faster than what we had expected. So this slide basically summarizes what happens with the climate change. If you see on one half of the slide over here, which is on the left side of the slide, if there is an increased CO2, you basically have majority of these effects which are positive on the plant. Let's say for biomass or yield or somatic function or whatever. So you have a basic positive impact. But what happens on the other end of the spectrum is, with increased CO2, then you lead to a cascade of events that you see on the other side of the slide over here, that is the right side of the slide. So with increased CO2, you get higher air temperature, and then this cascade of events that happens with the precipitation changes and sea level rise. So these two will induce more droughts, more salinity, and more flooding. Apart from that, higher temperature has a direct impact on the plants, particularly rice as well, with increasing the respiration rates as well as reducing the overall growing season as well, and the most importantly, the spikelet sterility, which leads to yield losses, and which where we have started to get reports from various South and Southeast Asian countries that there is, at times, it's not very regular, but this sort of a decline in yield, which is massive, is happening, it's not continuous. That's the main problem with temperature, because the losses starts to happen in 1 year, and it's very difficult to predict what's going to happen the next year. So that's been a major challenge by dealing with temperature stress. So just after that, sort of an overview of things of what is important, why we are dealing with rice and the different aspects of climate change. So my talk is basically divided into trying to highlight the progress with high temperature stress, drought stress, submergence, and salinity. And basically, when you go on to the field conditions, they don't occur independently on their own. They generally are companion stresses, which in different combinations occur under field conditions. And then I'll introduce to you what GRISP is, GRISP, or the Global Rice Science Partnership is. So as I said, I won't be able to do justice to the entire aspects that I have listed out in my outline, because there are four different groups which are working on these aspects. As you can see, that's my team, which is working mainly on high temperature stresses, which includes both high day temperature and high night temperatures, and also we deal with the heat and drought interactions. And then we have another group which is led by Arvind, who deals with the drought stress, and we have Sethi's group dealing with submergence, and the salinity group which is led by RK. So basically, I just put up this slide so that if people are interested in more details about what I present, feel free to contact these people. They should be happy to help you guys out. So moving on to temperature stress. So temperature stress, as you can see here, there have been many experiments which are done, and the temperature stress has a major negative impact during the reproductive stages. Mainly, as you can see in this slide, flowering is the most sensitive stage to high temperature stress. So even a few hours of high temperatures beyond critical thresholds happening during flowering can result in significant amount of decline, as you can see over here, to the extent of even 75 to 80%. But then the second most important stage is the microsporogenesis stage, which happens, say, about 9 to 10 days before flowering. And that also results in a significant amount of decline, not to the same extent although as flowering. So, focusing on the most important stage, which is very sensitive to heat stress, which is the flowering stage, we follow two different strategies. The first strategy is trying to escape this temperature stress. So in most of these cultivated rice varieties, they start to flower, rice variety starts to flower around, let's say, 9:30 starts off, but then the peak is somewhere during 10, 10:30 and 11 o'clock, where the temperatures are pretty hot during in the tropical or the subtropical countries. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to move the entire flowering to early hours of the morning, let's say around 8-ish, 8 o'clock, where the temperatures are relatively lower. And what you see here is after years of efforts, one wild rice, which is Oryza officinalis, had that trait. So that trait, which was then on chromosome 3, was taken up by some of the scientists at Erie. And then if you see in this figure, which is probably an excellent illustration of the strategy. So you have this wild type, which is basically a widely grown variety in AYR64, where quite a few of you might have heard about it. And then this is called as an EMF-NIL, which is the early morning flowering near isogenic line. What that means is, one single fragment of the wild rice has been genetically transferred into the wild type, which has resulted in the flowering much earlier than what the wild type does. So if you see here, most of the flowers have already finished flowering at 8:30, where the temperatures are much cooler. But in the case of the wild type, it doesn't even start flowering. So that's the sort of the strategies that we are following and trying to identify many of these lines across different locations or the sensitive, vulnerable regions where this trait can be utilized to sort of save and escape high temperature impacts. Now, well, most of this work has been done at Erie in Japan, so we're not very sure if this is really useful in case of field conditions. So, along with my colleagues, we went to Tamil Nadu and Delhi in India, where the temperatures are really hot. And as you can see, we have used a process which is called as standard sowing and followed by shading. Standard sowing was done mainly so that you have the same set of material blown at different time intervals, so that for sure the high temperatures go inside to flower. And the shading was used as a treatment in this condition because, as you can see here, this shading cuts off radiation and temperature and then creates a microclimate to the plant, which is very much similar to what happens during, let's say, 7:30 or 8 o'clock in the morning. So if this treatment is able to overcome the sterility, that means that introduction of the early morning flowering trait would be useful in these varieties. So that's the strategy. This work is ongoing. So the second strategy to try and deal, how do you deal with temperature stress during flowering, was trying to improve their tolerance. So if you are not able to move the flowering pattern, why not we induce a true tolerance itself? So we look at a wide range of genotypes, and right from 2008 we have looked at, I don't know, 100 or 150 different varieties. But then it still seems that one variety which is identified from eastern India, which is called as Nagina 22, is the most tolerant entry. And this has been utilized in most of the molecular studies as well as the genetic studies, including QDL mapping, metabolomics, proteomics, whatever you want to call it as. This is our standard check. And then our recent work also shows that this entry has got tolerance even at the microsporogenesis stage. If you remember the slide that I showed you, there's a second stage which is also sensitive to temperature. So we have tested many entries and N22 still performs good during this stage. and also with respect to high night temperatures. I'm going to deal with the high night temperatures a little bit later, but just to give you a flavor of things that N22 survives, whether it is high temperature during the day or during the night, either during the anthesis, which is flowering, or during microsporogenesis. So it's got very good sort of tolerance which is being utilized in the breeding program. So if you look at it, how do we really find out that they are different in the way they perform? For example, some of them are susceptible or some of them are tolerant. So you need to find out ways to sort of physiologically understand the mechanism behind these processes. So if you look at this here, I put up under stress condition, this is Morbericum, which is a susceptible entry, which is a japonica, and N22, which is a tolerant entry. And if you see here, the basal pore, which is much smaller when compared to N22, you might not be able to see it clearly, but we have measured the size of those pores in many of these experiments. So basal pore is very important because it's very much closer to the stigma, and only when the pores open does the pollen grain fall onto the stigma for the pollination. So if you look over here, under control condition, there is no problem. But when you give high temperature stress, Morbericum, which is susceptible, doesn't get any pollen grains at all on the stigma. So basically, there's no question of fertilization or pollination or pollen tube growth. But here, if you look at N22, it has got sufficient amount of pollen grains even under stress. The pollen are viable and they fertilize and they form set seed. So these sort of processes are continuously being devised to try and find out ways to sort of separate out the susceptible from the tolerant entries. So just to give you a glimpse of what we do, we, after identifying these contrasting entries, mapping populations are developed. It could be a ribbon population or different types of bicarabal populations that are being developed. And I put up two of these QTOs which have been identified. One is on chromosome 1 and the other one is on chromosome 4. These two have been identified across many studies, across different genetic backgrounds and locations. So these are some of the interesting QTOs where we are in the process of fine mapping, and these are really fine mapped to get molecular markers for them to be used for breeding. And the other approach, not only QTOs, but then we use the other candidate gene identification process, which is the proteomics approach using two-dimensional gel electrophoresis. So these identified genes or the proteins are then further validated using different techniques like QRT-PCR and a range of things. And then what happens is these genes, which are the candidate ones, goes through the transformation process for functional validation. Because once you identify a gene or a protein, you're not sure if it is really the one which is causing the effect. So you need functional validation for which there is a good transformation lab at Erie established. So it's sort of a pipeline, so if you get real good candidate genes, you work with these people to try and establish their functions. Well, the important thing is, we do point a lot of this work with respect to temperature, but temperatures are not a problem in the Philippines as of now. It's mostly to do with other tropical and subtropical countries like Iran, Senegal, India, some of these places. So these are the major target regions. So, well, basically, if you're dealing with temperature stress, temperature doesn't happen alone on its own, and the effect that you see is not driven just by temperature, but there is a strong interaction with the atmospheric relative humidity with temperature. So how does that happen? I'll just use a couple of slides to explain to you, giving you an example. So here you see a location which is Jessore in Bangladesh, yeah? So the temperatures are 35 degrees centigrade during March, which coincides with the critical phase, which is the flowering or the early grain filling stage, which is the most sensitive stage, yeah? And then if you look at the bottom, you have the relative humidity, which is 60%. So if you remember those numbers, on the next slide, in Pakistan, you will see that the temperatures reach about 40 degrees centigrade. Although the month is different here compared to that of the previous slide, because of the difference in the cropping pattern, the developmental stage of the crop is still the same. So September is a time wherein in Pakistan the plants will be at the flowering and the early grain filling stage. But if you look at it, the relative humidity is absolutely low. So basically what drives the entire temperature relationships, not just, well, basically for rice because it is fully flooded. If you go to another crop, there's a different equation, I guess. But it's a vapor pressure deficit, which is an interaction between the temperature and the relative humidity. So to put this in context of an experimental work, you could see this work which came out of Sri Lanka. If you look at this, there is an interaction with temperature and humidity. One is they have used four different entries, and what they have done is they have kept the temperature constant, and then they have just changed the relative humidity. So as soon as you increase the relative humidity from 60 to 85%, you can see that that should have been the sterile spirals. So this actually is not fertility, it's actually sterility, yeah, that's what it's like. So the sterility percentage, this basically is a fertile thing, sorry. So if this 60% relative humidity, you see these maroon bars which are much higher. So when there is low relative humidity, the VPD is very high. So you get high fertility. So as soon as you get high relative humidity, the VPD gets closer. So VPD is very important for the stomatal activity. So when the VPD becomes very small, then there is not good stomatal transpiration cooling. So the temperature is much more damaging. So that's why the temperature and relative humidity interactions are very important when you go on to the field conditions. So we try collaborating with the NAS partners and try and use this material, whichever it is bred at Uri, is sent to India and Bangladesh for testing. So the breeders who are there locally test this material to try and identify the lines that are interesting to them. So the question would be, when will we have a heat tolerant line, is some of the question that I have heard from a different set of audience that I have spoken to before. As you can see from this slide, we are basically here at this point where we have FineMap, both of those QTLs, and both the FineMap QTLs have been working well in a susceptible background. So we hope by 2015 or end of 2015 we should have some material which you can really call it as heat tolerant rice to be tested on the field. So those will be the first sort of material which will become available. Right. Now if you look at many of these reports with the global climate change, now they see a differential sort of an increase with the day temperature and the night temperature. So the night temperature is the one which is increasing at a much faster pace if you read any of these reports. And even with some of the publications that are coming out from Uri. All these are three high impact papers which have all come out from Uri, and these are all done under field conditions, so that's the beauty of it. So you wouldn't have any confounding effects of the controlled environment studies. Now all you see is a significant decline in yield when the night temperatures goes beyond 23 to 24 degrees centigrade. So we started to look at this. There was no physiological understanding until 2007 or the 11 why such an increase in high night temperature should have to reduce yield in rice. So we tried to replicate something like this under the field conditions. So these are called as the high night temperature tents. These tents are basically closed during the night time, and then there are air conditioners fitted with both heating and cooling facility under field conditions. So it's very realistic what happens under the field conditions. And then based on, we tested 43 different entries got from different locations and to try and identify, is there any genetic diversity for among these traits for high night temperature response. And then we identified the tails, which are the two contrasting entries, and then we wanted to look at the physiological understanding. So in the susceptible entry, which was affected greatly by high night temperature, basically the spikelet fertility was not affected. So it is quite different to what happens during the day temperature, because the day temperature induces a lot of spikelet sterility where the flower is formed but it doesn't fill. That's what happens. But during the night temperature, that was not affected, which was previously considered that could be the most important thing. But then what is being affected is the total biomass, the nitrogen content and the carbohydrate content just goes down in the susceptible. So the rate of grain filling is reduced and the grain width and the quality is deteriorated. So it's a different sort of effect that the high night temperature creates to induce decline in yields. So with high night temperatures, the hypothesis is maybe the carbohydrates are being used for the respiration or increased amount of the maintenance respiration during night time. And then that is what drives the decline in biomass and the NSC and the poor quality in rice. This is still unpublished, so this was recently published as well by one of my students. So if anybody is interested, can have a look at that right now. Right, these are some of the latest maps that have come out from the GIS team at Erie. What it shows is this is probably the first time that the maps have been developed on a global scale to show where the day temperature effects could be more and the night temperature effects could be more. Previously, all the maps which were developed were based on seasonal averages or monthly averages, but this is on daily averages. And then you have global planting gates which are used, which is probably the most unique thing in most of the GIS maps that have been developed previously. But what is interesting here is if you look at the day temperatures on the eastern coast of India, seems to be more of an effect. But then when you look at the night temperatures, the effect changes to closer to Bangladesh and the most the eastern sort of Orissa. So it appears that there might be different areas which could be affected by high day temperatures or high night temperatures, but that is yet to be validated using the ground through data. Now, that was the section on high temperatures. I probably took a bit longer because that's the whole thing where my team is working on. So I'll just move on to drought stress. So drought stress is basically done by another set of people at Erie, and there are two different approaches. One is a conventional approach and one is a molecular approach. So if you look at the conventional approach way back, say 5 years from now and before that, Erie had this sort of approach looking at the secondary traits like osmotic adjustment or leaf rolling and things like that in response to drought, and then trying to use them as phenotyping protocols to breed varieties. But then in 2007 and on, it's been grain yield has been the major target. So grain yield has been used to screen many of these varieties, and now we have come up with some types which are absolutely fantastic for drought stress, which I'll show you in the next slide. And the molecular approach is basically it's the same thing, because it's always been speculated that you would not have a QTL which is very stable across different environments for drought stress, especially for yield. But I think this was proven wrong over the past 4 years, so there have been many drought QTLs which are very stable have been identified and being used in the breeding program. So then once if you have the QTLs identified, then you can easily study the physiological and the molecular mechanisms. So if you look at this slide, what I was telling you about the conventional approach, these are the list of some of the interesting lines that you see here, and these are the check varieties. The idea for drought stress is under severe drought stress conditions, you don't breed a variety which can survive, you breed a variety which can produce. That's the basic philosophy. And also, if you're breeding a drought-tolerant variety, it's not that every year there will be drought. So you should. So the farmer is not ready to change the variety every year depending upon whether it is drought or non-drought sort of a year. So your variety should be able to produce when it is drought, especially like what it shows here. Under the non-stress condition, it performs equal to any of the other varieties which are growing as checks, but then under stress condition, beats them by massively by about 100%, just doubles under stress conditions. So that is under the lowland drought condition, and the upland drought condition, the story is just the same. And you might be wondering that QTLs, so how are these QTLs in drought stress when there are many being utilized? So there's a pyramiding approach where there's different combinations of these QTLs put together. So if you see here, this line has got four different QTLs using molecular markers which are transferred, and then their effect is seen. And if you look at the yield and the non-stress condition over here, under stress condition, they beat the check varieties by a great margin. And then under the non-stress condition, you can see they even go up to 7 tons per hectare. So the idea is if you have a variety and if your drought kicks in, this variety can still produce twice or three times more than your check variety. And if there is no drought, it still performs equivalent to any other variety. So that's the idea with the whole process. Submerge and salinity, I've just clumped them together for the purpose of time and to move ahead a little bit more quickly. Right, I think many of you might have heard about the submergence story from Erie, where basically it's been one of the most successful stories. Basically, it took, I think, more than 2 decades to come up with something like this. So this submergence tolerance gene, which was identified from FR13A on chromosome 9, has been published in Nature. And this line has been really utilized in other field conditions by the breeders. And as you can see in this next slide over here, that picture over here shows you the flash flooding, and it doesn't mean that in all these patches which are here that there was no rice crop. Actually, there was a rice crop, but it was the same as this one, but this one has a sub-1 gene in it, which is taken from the FR13A. So all these genotypes which were submerged for 14 days under water survived with a mechanism that has been published already. And then once the water recedes, then it starts to grow back again, which is just a miracle, I would say. So this has been utilized across many breeding programs, millions of hectares, I would say, at least thousands of hectares, if not millions. And then you would see majority of these varieties which are grown in Orissa, all these places in Bangladesh, they utilize this gene into their varieties because these are the submergence prone regions where there is lots of floods in these regions. And what's more important about this is, it's again similar to that of the drought story. If you have a submerged gene and if there is submergence, then they perform well. And if there is no submergence, they still perform good. So it's like an insurance policy. So you have it, if it comes, then it is helpful. If it doesn't, it's still fine, it still survives. So you don't need to do anything but basically have this gene in your basic variety and then it takes care of the rest. So pretty interesting stuff. So you might have seen that all complaining, some of the farmers might be complaining that transplanting is becoming a real difficult thing and there's always a difficulty to find labor. And nowadays, some of the agronomists might know that there is an increasing demand for adopting direct seeding as one of the options. But one challenge when you do direct seeding is where you just apply the seeds as such, weeds are a big problem. So to avoid weeds, you have to flood it, and if you flood it, the seeds won't germinate. So that's where the anaerobic germination comes into picture, that we have started to work on this. So what happens under anaerobic germination is you can put these seeds and then impound water, so that will stop the weeds to grow, but these seeds will grow because they have the ability to grow, germinate and anaerobically without any oxygen. And interestingly, if you look at it, FR13A was a donor which was for the submergence tolerance, but doesn't perform very well during anaerobic germination. But there are other varieties which perform much better than the donor. So that means to say that anaerobic germination and submergence are two independent things. So you could really combine them. And even if you combine, there won't be a negative impact. It was basically what might be. So this is just a slide to show you how basically they conduct this process. And this PTA was identified in chromosome 9. And as you see here, this is a process that they do, and this is the sort of phenotyping profile that is taken up to look for the tolerant and the intolerant accessions over here. Basically, the region of the chromosome 9 which houses this anaerobic germination tolerance has already been identified. And then if you see here, it's been narrowed down to 5 candidate genes, and I think they are now looking at the functional validation. So this should be published soon, probably a high impact factor again. I'll run through this slide, and what this slide shows is it's the same thing where the QTL has been identified for the seeping stage salinity tolerance. So there are efforts going on to try and look for similar sort of QTLs and genes for the reproductive stage and salinity as well. So I don't have the time, so I will just skip through this one. The other thing you might ask is, now, after speaking about temperature, drought, salinity and submergence, there are regions where that not just one of them occur at the same time. There's always a combination of them occurring under the field conditions. For example, when you don't have water, temperature also is higher for the plant. So there's a heat and drought interaction. So these are called as companion stresses. So there was an interesting matrix which was put by Midler in 2006 in France. If you look here, there's a significant negative impact with heat and drought and heat and salinity. And similarly, he was able to complete this matrix with the information that is available as of now. So, looking at that in more detail, some of the mapping studies which came out of Erie and it's been published, if you can see here, the South and Southeast Asian region, the first map shows the regions which were affected by high temperatures during the flowering and the early grain filling, which is a sensitive stage. And on the other side, this represents a drought stress. If you look at it, the intensity of the drought and the heat seems to coincide, and the regions which are susceptible to temperature and drought are pretty much the same. So it's reasonable to start to say that you would require something of a heat and drop tolerance device in that. So the progress which is achieved with heat stress mapping the QTS or GS is tried to combine with that of the drop tolerant lines so that we can induce both heat as well as drop tolerance in those varieties. And one other, so we call this as a two-in-one approach. You could also do three-in-one depending upon your location, but then also depending whether your QTL has a positive impact or a negative impact. Now you would ask, why are you guys combining drought and submergence? Drought is this absolutely lack of water, and submergence is the excess amount of water. Why do we really have to combine this? So if you look at it, these regions which get flooded, they get flooded only the initial part, and then the water drains out, and then there is no more rains in most of the cases. So then at the terminal stage, you start to get drought stress. So you might have the submergence, you might escape the flooding, but later on at the flowering stage, you need drought tolerance, otherwise you don't get any yield. Basically, that's as simple as that. So the reason for going with this approach is now we are trying to combine both drought and submergence, so these regions survive the submergence when there is floods, and then there is no rainfall, the drought tolerance kicks in later on during the flowering stage and gives some sort of a yield to the farmer who would otherwise have nothing in these regions. One other thing as a tier 2 in 1 sort of is the submergence and the salinity. I would rather come back to this after dealing with this slide. Sorry, it's the other way around. So if you look at this map over here, these are the major paleozoic regions of Vietnam, Myanmar, as well as Bangladesh. And if you look closely at these graphs, then you see the majority of the proportion of these yields, or rice yields, which comes from these regions in Vietnam, Bangladesh, and Myanmar, are all deltaic. So these are very close to the coastal regions. So now, if you look at it, these are close to the coastal regions and have the vulnerability to be affected if the sea level rise happens. Now going back to the slide gives you an understanding why we are trying to combine submergence and salinity. So being so close to the coastal conditions, it will be submerged. And the submergence is not happening with good water. It's happening with saline water because it's close to the coastal regions. And that's why there is a reason for combining both submergence and salinity together. If you can look at it, some of you might have, you know, really looked at this tanks if you pass right across this road, and this will be saline water, and these plants over here are the windows where you can see they are submerged. So basically there is submergence with salt water. So anything that survives, this is how the screening process takes place. And if you look at it in the field condition, if you have only submergence tolerance, when it is submerged with saline water, it basically doesn't perform very well. But if you have salinity tolerance as well as submergence, it performs much better. So practically, these are absolutely very useful for a farmer's condition. You can always spend years studying the physiological mechanisms or the molecular mechanisms of this, but the most important point is to get this onto the field where it really matters. And that's I think, is the fascinating part of breeding and working with these people to try and see that happen under the field conditions. Similarly, if you look at it again, there's an interaction with the temperature as well as with relative humidity and salinity. So if you have the lower amount of relative humidity, this is what I was talking to you about. So when the humidity goes down in the air, the transpiration increases. So when the transpiration increases, just because there's no moisture just next to the plant, it takes up more water. But what if the water is full of salts? So it takes up more saline water. So that's why if you see here, the effect is much more when you have saline water and low relative humidity. So, but if you have high relative humidity, the amount of water taken up is less. So there's less salts taken up indirectly because the water is saline. So then they perform much better here. So it's basically a combinations of this happens under field conditions. That's what you need to, any of you guys who are working in either agronomy or any other aspect, you need to keep that focus in mind. Like you're doing this, what happens under the field conditions? How do you draw parallels to the sort of work that you're doing? How useful is that? So then you can try and change your hypothesis and your work accordingly, which fits what is really needed. So having that foresight is very useful and very interesting also. Right, I've come to the close of my talk. So I just just wanted to introduce to you something which happened, I think, 2 or 3 years ago, which is now called as Global Life Science Partnership, which is an evolving partnership. Previously, IRI, Africa Rise, SIAT, and many other partners used to work independently on their own, but now it's all come under one single umbrella, which is called as GRISP. So basically, any RISE research which happens across the world comes under this umbrella. That's how it has been created. So there's 900 different partners in this, so led by IRI, of course, and then it's an evolving alliance. So any person who is interested to come and join this, you're always welcome. Either directly as an institute or as a research team or a project or whatever, anything is welcome. Some of the financial support I have to thank is mainly the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which gives us quite a lot of money, and USAID from the US, and BMC, a German donor. And what I want to tell, because most of them are students here, so I thought I would put up this slide, which is might be useful. According to here, you see, in 2011, there was something called as a Global Rice Science Scholarship, which was given, I think, 11 to 15 PhDs were given out at that time, but then they couldn't continue the next year. But now, if you look here, which is called as a Leaf Foundation Rice Scholarships Program, which is still under GRISP, but they've got the money and they're funding 18 PhDs. 18 PhDs, you can register in Cornell or wherever, and many different aspects. There are 4 different areas. If you go to any website, training center, you can see the Leaf Foundation. And anybody who is in South and Southeast Asia is eligible to apply. So I thought that information might be useful for you guys. Okay. So basically, that's about it. So I'm ready to take questions if you have any.
Dr. Krishna, the floor is now open for our audience to direct your comments, your questions to our speaker. Please use the microphone around the room and kindly identify yourself and the organization that you are representing. Any questions from the floor? Who's going to throw in the first question? Yeah, Dr. Krishna said it can also be comments.
It can also be comments on some things that you think can be done much better than what we are doing, so that's also welcome, for sure.
Mark Rovigna, Field Rights, Philippine Rights Research Institute. I have 3 questions, one of which is, what's the grain type of the N22, why it differs in terms of tolerance from the others? Is it also a Japonica indica or Blue type? Second question is, you said the heat tolerant, is it temperature tolerant variety? Because your parents come from N22 and IRP, it's coming 2015. How heat tolerant would that, up to what temperature would that be? And the third, which is a very fascinating one, is the submergence and salt tolerant. When will the variety be coming? And by the way, one last comment is that you have a very fascinating and very, very highly informative climate change information.
Thank you. So I'll go from the last. Thanks for the nice comment that you made at the 4th point. So the first point, N22, now that's the problem with most of these varieties which are land races which are identified. So submergence came out from FR13A, which is a land race. So agronomically a very poor crop. So what we do is we try to fish out why that FR13A was interesting, and through genetics you pick only those genes, but we're not basically interested in FR13A. Similarly, N22, right through 1980s, there have been, I think, 30 papers on this, and it still remains the most tolerant. But it's agronomically a very poor crop. It has very weak stem, very small grain, and we are working with Normi Manikas from Field Rice. So right from, I think, 3 or 4 years from now, we are working with him. So he has a mutant population in N22, etc. But as I said, again, we are using proteomics approach, transcriptomic approach to identify those candidate genes in this landrace, which is N22, and identify and pick them and get molecular markers and move that gene into IR64, let's say, or NCCAR622. So basically, it's tolerant, but it is not good at running. So you just take the genes, what is good, and then leave the rest sort of a thing. And when would that variety come? 2015, we would have lines which show tolerance, but the tolerance is around, it's increasing fertility, or it's maintaining fertility by about 15%. It's variable, it's not correct, it's about 10 to 15% depending upon the age. So most of this testing has taken place under controlled environment chambers at Erie, because we don't have good phenotyping, or the temperatures are not hot or easy, right, or Philippines. So we plan to ship those materials to these hot spots, test them, and actually see what is the gain that is happening with these heat tolerant lines. So that will happen in 2015. So the variety coming out basically depends upon the NAS partners seed evaluation and release committee guidelines. So we just provide this material, if the breeders find it interesting, they can take it, they can release it in their own country, but depending upon their guidelines. So I can't say that the variety will come out, but the material could be somewhere available in 2015-16. With respect to salinity and submergence, I think the material is already available and being tested in most of the locations, but this has to be kept in mind that the salinity is for seedling stage tolerance. So at the earlier stages, these are already being deployed in quite a lot of the coastal regions where you have this submergence. And it's proven very good as well, as I showed you in the slide, but that was in the experimental side, but even in the farmer's field, it's doing good. But we don't have yet a stable material for salinity tolerance at reproductive stage, I think, as far as I know. So I think I answered. Are you satisfied? If there is anything. Again, just for the students, it's a fantastic opportunity. Don't miss it. If somebody of your graduate students, you don't get such an opportunity. You can register anywhere and you can do your work.
They understood your presentation very well, because they have no questions, and I think that's a positive feedback.
You can write to any of the people who were in the slide, so I would rather bring, because I know students are very shy. I was a student once. I used to have so many questions sitting there, that, yeah, maybe this is wrong, but I go back and then discuss with my friends. So I would leave this up there. So I've gone through this whole thing. I myself am a poor master, so I don't ask questions in these seminars. So if you find anything that you want to ask, feel free. And you can share this email ID with us, your friends. We're always open, either collaboration or you want to do a part of your research if you're interested in any of these stresses. So I leave that slide open for you guys. So if you're shy, you can get back to us.
Oh, there's one from Dr.
Bergen. This is not a question, but I think you have to explain to the students. I was also once a student and very shy. So even if I need some money for my thesis, I don't know how to ask and who to ask. So maybe what are the qualifications that you need to bring if I have to go to Erie, if I were one of the students? How simple should it be? Or, what approach do I do if I am one of these students here and I have some problem for my thesis, for BS or MS, or PhD? How do I go about it?
So I'll start off with the Lee Foundation thing, and then I'll come back to the later stuff as well. So the Lee Foundation, there's an application which you can download on the internet, on the training center. You just have to fill it out. And if you like any of these areas and you want to work with any of them, but register in some other outside university, then you work with these people which are listed in these areas, if it is in these areas, yeah? Then you can develop a proposal discussing with this person. and then you can submit that proposal for this scholarship. Yeah, that's one way of doing it. But simply telling that apart from the Lee Foundation, if there are some people who want to come and work at Erie, just like that, no, for their thesis and things like that. I've got two people in mind. One is from the molecular and cell biology, who's working in, doing her master's in the in UPLB, and the other one in environmental sciences. So I think it's basically the drive. I look for the drive in the students. So when I speak to them, you can always come and see them. You say what you're interested in, but what I suggest is, if you really are interested in work in hearing, you can impress the supervisor by doing your groundwork before coming there. So if you come there and ask the person who is sort of busy with other things that I would want to do but I don't know what to do, then the person wouldn't be able to help you much. Right? So but if you go there and say, this is what I'm interested in, I think I want to do in this area, are you interested to make me a student? That then triggers. So it basically shows how interested you are, how much background you have done, and it's not basically that you want to do your research at ERI, but you want to do good research. Now that's the thing that we look for in students. So it's a drive and not looking at the watch when you work. This is what is more sort of the philosophy. So there's no time limitation when you're working. If the work is not done, you just continue. Just finish up. Sorry, that's how I look.
I'd like to add that many of these students have not visited Erie. You can always visit Erie and try to see or join some in the Reiswold
Museum. Is
yeah, that? It will expose you to what rice research aspect you can do, even in that rice museum.
Yeah, it's very nearby. I would be surprised. You guys should drop down and just look for opportunities. So many opportunities, right? It's open to everybody, I suppose.